So Lightroom just got a brand new feature, and it's one of the most useful features to come to Lightroom in a long time, and that is automatic landscape masks. Let's check them out right now. The big new feature inside of Lightroom Classic April 2025 update is a landscape masking, and this really is game-changing. What I'm going to do, though, is I'm going to show you some of the weaknesses of it, and I'm also going to throw a few little tips and some tricks along the way to kind of help you refine these pictures. So let's start with this picture I shot at Yosemite, and yes, when you teach Photoshop and Lightroom, you get to show everybody your worst images. All right, this one definitely needs some help. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to go into the Develop module, and by the way, in Camera Raw, this works identical. So if we go across and then we just click the mask, you're going to see there's a new option now, and it's landscape mask. This works very much like the people selection, and in that the AI identifies different parts of the photograph and attempts to mask them. And sometimes it works good and sometimes it doesn't work so good. Let's have a look. We're going to grab landscape. Right now it's detecting what's on this image. And we'll do a different image after this to show you some different things. All right, so we can see it sees the sky, mountains, vegetation, and water. Now, if you want to select just the sky or just the mountains or water, you can select them here. But let's select all of them. And then we have the option here to create four separate masks. If we don't, it'll just create a mask of pretty much the whole thing. So let's choose Create Mask. And then you'll see the masks panel. Now, your mask panel might be docked in here. You can tear it off and it's a floating panel. Or you can just have it docked here. It's up to you. I'm going to have it floating. I think it makes it a little bit easier for us to work with. All right, so we've got the sky here has been isolated, and you can see it as we roll over it. We can see the mountains. We can see the vegetation. And then we can see the water. And the water, of course, is that waterfall. So before I do any adjustment, I just want to adjust the entire image. So let's go into the settings here. This will take us to the basic panel. And let's just open up the exposure a little bit because the whole thing is a little bit too dark. All right, let's go back to the masks. Notice the masks are still there. So why don't we start with the mountains? So let's click on the mountains. Notice that they're all selected now. And we can increase the exposure. We can brighten these mountains if we want. Let's open up the shadows a little bit. And notice on the right, they're starting to look a little bit hazy. So let's go down and do a little dehaze. So just give it a little touch of dehaze, not too much. Great. Next thing I want to do is just warm it up a little bit, because sometimes when I have rocks and mountains and things, sometimes it looks nice to warm them up just a touch. So I'm going to take the temperature, just give them a little bit, just kind of brings out a little bit of the color there in those rocks. Now this waterfall is starting to look a little bit blown out, so let's go to the water. And here we are in the water. And let's take the highlights back. So we can start to see detail in the water. See that detail is there, but I still want to pop the whites on there. So we're going to take the whites here and just kind of give that a push. So what that does is it takes the bright areas, reduces the milkiness, and makes them nice and clean while we're still preserving some of the details and the highlights without blowing it out. And just because we warmed up the rocks, I want to make it pop just a little bit. So I'm going to take the temperature and just slightly move it to the left. Not very much, just a little bit. It's not noticeable, but it's creating just a little bit more separation. Okay, next thing we want to do is the foliage or the vegetation. So if we click on the vegetation though, notice that it's also selected the vegetation at the top here. If I turn the overlay off for a second, we can see, okay, there are some trees there. But there's not really any trees. It's pretty barren on these areas. And so it didn't really do a good job of selecting that. Notice it got some of the shadows and it thinks that that's also vegetation. So what we want to do is we want to refine that selection. So on the vegetation, we're going to click on it. And this is going to open the options. And then we're going to choose Subtract. Now the tool we're going to use is the brush. So I'm just going to choose the brush. And now we see the brush with a minus. That means wherever I paint, I'm going to remove that mask, and we want to remove it from the top here because we don't want to be affecting any of this vegetation in here or the tops of the mountains because it's just not going to turn out good. All right, let's go there and some of those shadows, we can take those away. Let's go the other side. Now you might want to keep some of those if you wanted to, you know, maybe kind of pop those, but in this situation, we're not going to. So it's not that it's not useful. Like sometimes selecting those ones across the top could be useful, but just not in this particular circumstance because I just want to focus on the bottom here. All right, so if we take the exposure and we can brighten that up, see we can brighten up these trees, and I'm going to take the shadows and open those up a little bit. Now notice as I do that, notice it starts to look, let me show you here, it starts to look foggy. And that's because it does not do a very good job of selecting in between the trees, as you can see there. It's not a great mask. And this kind of situation, Photoshop actually does a better job. But the way to get around that is to just kind of go a little subtle. Don't push it too far. And I'm just going to push the blacks in here a little bit, because notice these hazy parts here. If I push the blacks in a little bit, it's going to kind of just get rid of that fogginess a little bit. Now, the other way we could go in here, if we wanted to do that, is to choose Subtract. And then under Subtract, we can go in and we can use the Color Range. So with the Color Range selected, let me show you this. We can go into this bluish kind of tone here and just kind of tap there. And notice what that does is it selects that and removes it. So if we look at the Color Range before and after, see how it does a nice job of getting in there and kind of refining that mask. It's a little strong though, so let's take the amount and just going to kind of take that back a little bit. And then once again, let's have a look at the Color Range before, after. See how it's getting rid of that foggy kind of edge there? So we can use those tools to help us. And I might want to warm that up a little bit. So I'm going to take that temperature, warm up that foliage a little bit, because that's what that's going to do, is just going to kind of separate it a little bit. And I might even just go a little saturation, which is not something I do a ton, but in this case, I'm going to just kind of make those come alive a little bit more. And once again, separate them from the less colorful rocks in the background. All right, we're getting pretty close. Let's go to the sky. And normally I'm darkening the sky, but in this situation, because I underexposed the photo, and by the way, I underexposed it so I wouldn't blow out the detail on the waterfall, I'm going to brighten up that sky a little bit because we don't need that sky to be quite so blue. So we can kind of brighten that up a little bit. Let me dock the mask so we can kind of see where we are. And if we look at this, here we are before and there we are after. And you can see a significant improvement in this image. And this is a very difficult image because it's got a lot of detail and very similar kind of color between the rock and the foliage in the foreground. So definitely not an easy challenge, but notice it's done a pretty good job. Now the masks, as you saw, were not perfect, but they're definitely good enough for us to be able to make this adjustment and save a lot of time from making those selections manually. Let's move on to a different example where I'm going to show some other things. Let's have a look at this image. There's something interesting I want to show you in here. So if we choose Develop, and then we're going to grab our landscape once again, same as before. And it looks like we've got sky. Great. We've got mountains. Great. And then I wondered about this ground because this is actually mud. It's not a paved road. And so it sees that as a natural ground, which is interesting. Okay, I like that. And let's create a mask. So it knew it wasn't cement. Okay, so here's the thing. If I go in here and I want to adjust the sky, I could. If I want to adjust the mountains, I could. But notice when we do natural ground, it's also seeing the mountains as part of that natural ground. So we could end up with a double adjustment. I just want the ground and not the mountains. So what we can do is we can click on natural ground, and then I'm going to choose subtract. And then under subtract, I'm going to go down and I'm going to select landscape once again. This time I'm going to choose mountains and then create mask. And if you look at that, now it's just got the ground by itself without the mountains. So sometimes it gets a little confused, and that's kind of how you can get around that. So if we want to do the sky here, you know, bring the highlights back. Let's give it some little bit of pop there, maybe darken it a little bit. All right, so we got some sky. Let's grab the mountains. I'm going to take the shadows, open them up a little bit, and I'm also going to warm these up a little because, once again, I love to warm up rocks very often. And then we can do something with the ground. Let's look at the natural ground here. Maybe we'll just warm this up a little bit. And I don't want to brighten up that natural ground, but you could, as you can see here, you've got complete control over it. I'm actually just going to keep it there a little bit dull because it's not that interesting. The rock is the most interesting part of the photograph. All right, so this is where this could get interesting. Let's go back to the mountains though really quickly. And I want to give this one just a little bit of sharpening on this rock. So I could go up under detail and just take sharpness there, which is going to work nicely, but I also want to give it a little bit of effect. So we're going to go to the texture here and pump up the texture. Look at that. Nice. All right. So what if I just suddenly remember, oh yeah, that's right. I shot this in two parts. Oh, I forgot all about that. Well, maybe I'm going to merge a pano. Generally speaking, you would merge a panorama first, then make the adjustments. But say you forgot. Let me show you what you're going to do. You're going to take the image here with the adjustments on it. I'm going to hold the shift key and then select the one I want to apply it to and choose sync. And then under sync, we're going to choose masking and synchronize. And the AI is going to select that. So just so you can see how well it works, notice completely different shape. And it was able to isolate that and apply the same adjustments so that, yes, you can make smart presets. And then another thing worth bearing is when we look at the natural ground, notice those mountains are not included in the ground on that other one either. All right, so let's merge these together. Right click, we're going to choose photo merge, and let's just merge to panorama. Now I have other tutorials on this, so we're not going to get into it too much. So there's different ways we can do this. By the way, another new feature that is in Lightroom Classic is we have this checkerboard pattern, not just in here, but inside of Lightroom when we are cropping. So instead of just showing white now, we see this checkerboard, which we recognize from Photoshop. All right, so maybe I want to do something like auto crop. So this is going to crop it down. Okay, so we need a little bit more to that. So that's clearly not going to work unless we choose a boundary warp. And then we're going to push that out a little bit. And check out my tutorials on Lightroom and Camera Raw creating panoramas where I describe what all of this does. All right, great. That shows a nice edge there. And then we're just going to choose merge. And this is going to create a brand new panoramic image. And here it is. But notice it doesn't have the adjustments. No problem. So let's click one of the ones we already did. Right click. Develop settings. Copy settings. Copy that mask. And then we're just going to go in here, select our pano, right click, develop settings, and we're going to paste those settings. And look at that. It was able to detect the edge of that mountain there and apply that adjustment exactly how we wanted it. All right, so as you saw, I chose some difficult images so we could really test those masks. And as you can see, they do need a little bit more work to get those masks a little bit more precise. But what you're gonna find though, is for the majority of your images that you're working on, these are gonna save you a ton of time and they're gonna work really well. So by now you probably realize that masks are the key to getting really good edits inside of Camera Raw and Lightroom. And if you don't already have it, check out my course on masking inside of Lightroom and Camera Raw. So this course will give you a firm foundation on working with masks, and it's full of tips and tricks, and I also include all the images that I'm working on. Now this was as in the previous version, but 100% of this is still applicable, and I think it's really going to help you. And I'll drop a discount code in the comments underneath for those of you who don't already have this course. But anyway, drop a comment underneath and let me know what you think of this new update. And also check out my video here on the new features inside of Photoshop. And if you're new, welcome to the cafe. Hit the subscribe button and turn on notifications so you don't miss any of my tutorials. And until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.